to the extent that you guys are. I mean, that's a thin line between who's a conservationist and what is the line of conservation that we do. Now, getting back to filmmaking, our observations in the field have been varied over multiple landscapes. Because, for example, when we film various species, unlike how a single animal is being studied in one particular landscape, we travel across different landscapes to film various animals. So on that, I'm not comparing myself with completely with a primatologist or saying that we are better than this or that. I'm just saying what filmmakers are good at. So it's more about how we observe things and we record such events and pass it on to scientists and we collaborate with them. That's one of the important things that we do. And so obviously we do a lot of time in the field spending on recording events and things that have never been documented before or recorded before, bringing out the visual evidence of what really happened. So for sometimes I've been in the field recording a certain number of activities of, let's say, a monkey coming and eating a jackfruit, a lion-tailed macaque for that instance. So the number of times that a particular individual came to eat on the jackfruit was recorded over a long period of time in a single sitting. So I recorded this event and gave the exact timings to the scientists for them to study about it. And they were really happy to figure out and what intervals the animals were coming and what exactly was going on in the field. Obviously, there's more to that, but I'm just pointing out that there are these key things that we contribute to as we film while sitting over there in the field and spending a lot of time. Perhaps this is all studied from you guys, how to sit in the field and what to do. So, of course, that's a huge help for us. The next thing is communicating science for a wide audience. So this is one key thing that we'd love to do using films, which is because the data that you have, which you always help us with these films, we take it out into films and we share it across various platforms that reaches. For example, this sequence that I just showed you was shown for more than 15 lakh people. And such small incidents and the exposure that's the people have to get about such species and the landscape is quite huge, which is a very key thing, how we communicate science to an audience. Then we try audience to relate to science. Obviously, science, when people think about it, they're always like, oh my God, we just want to stop it right there, because they don't really, I mean, from a common person's perspective, they just want to stop it right there, which everybody here knows, which is where audiovisuals play a key role in bringing the science to them. We make it easy. We think from the audience perspective of what really do they like. For example, there are various categories. Let's say a movie that is being made for US audience to the ones made for the German audience is much different. For example, when I am filming a slender loris, for one particular shot, I would keep it for not more than 15 seconds for a US audience. Similarly, the same thing, I would keep it for German audience for about 2 minutes and they would sit and watch without getting bored. This is the variance, and we need to know the and understand an audience before we make out a film, before we structure a story. So it's all about storytelling to these people, and that's the easiest way how we can take it to them. Obviously, there's a lot of people who think that, oh my God, you're screwing up science, you're breaking it down, you're bringing it down. Without that, it's just going to look like a CCTV footage, because without the creative inputs, without the creative story cutting or edits or even the unnatural sounds that we add in, it's going to look like a CCTV footage, and not anyone is going to be interested in looking at it with an attention span of more than 30 seconds. That's very difficult. And this creative edge gives us a good upper hand in controlling what an audience can perceive. Obviously, some people go to certain extents, which is bad, but keeping it this way, I think from at least my perspective, it's a good thing to reach out to a larger set of audience. So some of the incidents that I was telling that I have never recorded before have been documented that I've passed on to these such people was useful because of filmmaking techniques. I'll just share a few clips again so that you can have a look. Just quickly going to that. I wanted to share this particular shot or sequence of fetal cannibalism. This was never recorded for the lion-tailed macaques previously. So I just took a small, obviously I was lucky to be at the right place at the right time, but still, it all depends on how good you make use of the event to make such things. Uh, It says my screen sharing has been paused. Just a second. I hope it comes back again now. Let me go to it. Resume share. Okay, I've got a technical issue here. Very sorry about that. Let me stop sharing. Sorry about that. I'll just open it and then try it again. Yeah, I think now it's up. I'll show you the screen right now. This, I recorded it about 2.5-3 meters away from this female who just gave a miscarriage and she was feeding on her fetus. I'm sorry to most of the people who think this is a bit graphic, or I mean, I was just thinking that all of you are scientists and researchers here, so I didn't think you would be minding about this. And she left out a little piece of the fetus over there and walked away. I was sitting and watching if there was any other animal that was coming behind to feed on it. Surprisingly, it was just another female who came and checked it out. Obvious reasons, they were just inquisitive. Didn't do much, just toppled it around and walked away. So this is one thing that I wanted to share. And I'm sorry, it's going to be a lot of visuals that I will be showing because that's exactly what I do. And the other thing that I wanted to show was a mourning ceremony that I had filmed in the field. So there was a road accident once in one of these forests when I was filming the lion-tailed macaque. The animal was discarded into the forest by the forest department for I don't know for what reason. But then I thought I'll follow these animals and sit there, the carcass especially, sit along with it and see what happens around it. I was sitting there for about 2 hours, and this was about 3 meters away from the animal, the carcass. But slowly the troops started coming in only after 2 hours of waiting. They slowly came in, and I'll just show you exactly what happened. And as it goes on, I'll just start narrating. I'll quickly share the screen. Please hold on with me. Okay, once again, it says my screen sharing is off. I have no idea why. Let me try it again. Please hold on. Sorry for making you guys wait. Just need to get the sequence there. Okay, I think I should be able to do it right now. Quickly share. Okay, there it is, sharing. Just a build up to that thing. I was making this small segment to show to Jane Goodall when I was having a conversation with her about lion-tailed macaques. This was the carcass. Just take it to that and. So what happened was, after the first troop came in and was checking her out and caressing her, grooming and all that, there was a very different natural history moment that happened, which you could have seen on the screen. There were three different troops, multiple different troops are there in one location, and three different troops of the lion-tailed macaque came in to mourn the dead. it was quite strange for me because I've always seen them fighting with amongst each troops, because every time there's another troop, it's usually war there. But this time it was quite surprising for me when I could see just the second group coming. I mean, the second troop coming morning or whatever they were doing. I was just calling it morning. And then immediately after they moved out, the third troop came in, they finished whatever they had to do, the ceremony, and then they headed out. During the entire time, I was observing the first troop, the Caucasus troops, male, sitting about 5 or 6 meters away from the entire thing, what was happening, and then waited for the other troops to move out. And then every time one of the troops left, it would just come in and it would start mourning for the carcass. This was quite a recording that I had, that I made a small pitch about this, and I showed it to the researchers in the field base over there. They were quite intrigued and they were starting to study what was actually going on. And they explained about, are you sure whether these are different troops? I was like, I'm absolutely sure, because I could recognize with one of the troops coming in and the certain scars that I could recognize from previous photographs. And I also made a call outside to another person, to one of my assistants who was on the road about 50 meters away from the jungle. And I asked them whether it was confirmed that the first troop had moved out and the second troop had come in. And it was confirmed that it was the same. And that's where I could see also the current male, the male from the main troop was also sitting out and just waiting for the other troops to come in and mourn and just pass on. So such things obviously give us a good opportunity to share the events, what goes on in the field with the outside. So obviously audiovisual language is a very strong information for a lot, many people, and even for research, I would say.
Varun?
So the other things, I mean, not just about primates, there are other things which I've filmed, which has never been filmed in the wild before. For example, like gharial crocodiles hatching out of eggs and coming out. I'll just show you the clips perhaps later.
Varun, can you hear me?
That segment. But right now I'll just move on to the next segment, which talks about how I do this or how we filmmakers do this in the field. The first thing, like primatologists, Varun? We also try to gain the animal's trust. Slowly coming into what we don't do these days, or what I've learned from primatologists, what we shouldn't be doing with the animals is, initially I used to gain the trust from these animals by behaving in a certain way, doing the body language thing, just behaving how they would and making them comfortable. There were incidents where one of the animals, I was in a scenario, I was just filming macaques just playing around. There was nobody around me. There were no assistants that day. I was just sitting on the ground and filming comfortably. Suddenly, there was a hand on my back. And I was extremely shocked because I just turned and saw, as I was thinking that there was nobody around, there was a macaque just resting on my back and then looking into the screen what I was filming. The way I reacted, even the macaque got shocked and it just moved away. I mean, that time it felt, I was like, okay, fine. I'm getting one amongst the troop. They're accepting me as part of the troop. But the truth was this, they were just getting used to their with my presence around. Okay, there's a question. Okay, there are several questions here. I hope it's fine for me to answer in the end. I hope that's all right.
Yeah, I think that is fine. Can you hear me, Varun?
Yeah, so that was one of the incidents where I was really shocked, but although I felt really happy that I was part of the troops and everything. That was actually not true when I came to know about it in the later stages. For example, one of the times, one of the macaques, a young male, a lion-tailed macaque, was sitting on the top of my car. When I was trying to go near the vehicle, it was acting very comfortably when I was around. And when I went close, it started grooming my hair. So although this was quite a nice thing that I felt it was happening, I came to study that it was a bad thing for the animals. Obviously, we don't know all the rules and the things about the wild places. We came to know about that slowly. This was in my initial stages, and immediately I came to know about the primatologists, how to react. For example, one of the senior primatologists, Sushma, she was in the field, and when I was filming her with the lion-tailed macaques, one of the animals was feeling comfortable with her, and when it was walking closer to her, she just immediately turned away and walked far. I asked her why she did that. She said, the animals must not get used to us because that's not good for them and it's dangerous for them. That hit hard. And ever since, I've always been staying away from them. Obviously, I've got a lot of kicks and bounces on me from langurs when I filmed them. One of the incidents when I was filming them in Rajasthan, there was a gray langur that just jumped on me when I was filming a small baby, like really up close. I realized that I was looking at the animal in a very aggressive way, because I was actually looking into the viewfinder and filming the animal. And the one of the females thought I was... okay, I'm on mute. Okay, I just have to ask Partha if I'm on mute or if someone else is on mute. No, you are. Okay, thanks. This incident when I was filming the baby, the female came and kicked on my back and it just went. It was a huge hit. But then I was thinking that, okay, maybe it was just annoyed. And when I later retrospected about what was actually happening, I was like concentrating really bad and it was as if a predator looking at them. And ever since, I just changed my strategy. I just put on my glasses and I would look this way, and while my eyes were just pointing at the animals. Never after that, they kicked me even once. So slowly strategies changed and things got better. I mean, this is the same that I've also followed with several other animals, like filming Indian gors. Sometimes I've gone even up to, I mean, not me, the animals have come up to 3.5-4 feet from me, the Indian gors. That was because I was just behaving very comfortably with them and they were not alarmed at all. And I've got extreme close-ups and even to certain positions where I couldn't even get the shots because they were that close. This has happened to the primates as well. But during this instance, a lot of times when I felt the animal gets disturbed, I just walk out telling that, okay, I don't need the shot today. Reasons because the animal is getting disturbed. I mean, I'm fairly sure that's what you guys would suggest me to do as well, which is what I've learned from some of the field biologists. So that's one of the things.
Varun, hello.
Some of the strategies that I use while filming is to think how the primates would think. I mean, this is only obviously giving me a certain extent of how much they could think, because obviously we cannot think what the animals are thinking. But to a certain extent, by looking and observing their behavior, I was able to think about what would be the animal's next move. For example, the sequence that I showed you and maybe the next one that I'm going to show you, a lot of the frames we set up and wait for the animal to come in, yes, but we cannot wait for the same frame a whole day. That doesn't happen in most of the scenarios. For that incident, for that instance, we start thinking about how the animal would start thinking. The squirrel and the lion-tailed macaque slap that we filmed had a certain a very specific strategy. We knew there was a ripe jackfruit in one of the places, so I was just waiting for there. This was the same place where a squirrel also was there, because I had also already observed the squirrels coming to one place, and when they were ripping off the jackfruit, if the troop was nearby, they would get the scent, come in, try to push away or scare away the squirrels and then get over for the jackfruits. An easy meal maybe for some of the younger adults in the troop. So while we were looking at this and observing, we saw that it was happening in a place where there were two giant squirrels. So immediately I positioned my camera and I was waiting to see if there was a troop coming anywhere closer. I positioned about three of my assistants about 50 meters from each other to a certain, they were all equidistant, and it was up to 150 meters that I was just having people and all of them were on call, looking around if there was any macaque troop coming in. As soon as the first spotter called in and told me that this is happening, I immediately went on for the shots that I needed to fill up the squirrel's potion. I finished all that. I was waiting for this to happen. And as we thought, the troop was coming closer to this particular area, and I was 100% sure that the troop was going to inspect some of the jackfruits in this area, and this could probably be one of it. And it was just a probability, but the probability was really high at that incident. As I was thinking, one of the young males started coming closer and closer. It was the only one. It was probably one of the young adults who wanted to just come in and have a free meal. Or maybe it was just looking out for what was whether the fruit was ripe. So as soon as it started climbing the tree, the whole sequence began rolling, and we were waiting for it to come in. And as you saw, the particular thing happened out. Yes, there is a lot of luck involved, but strategy, like I said, we think before. And thanks to you guys, because a lot of your data and your observations, which we try to learn from and collaborate from, is how we try to manage such prior strategies for such animal behavior. And say, already Partha was introducing me that I love filming animal behavior. Yes, we do have something in common between us, which is which I'm very proud about, which is the love for primates and how they behave in the field or in their landscapes. A lot of times we sit, like I've already told about how long we sit and observe for these behavior. There have been several incidents where I have not even taken the camera to the field, just sat out and observed them using the binocs, and they're thinking, okay, what are the animals doing? How are their movements? And noting down everything so that I can think, okay, maybe if the animal does this, this could be another probability, or this could be another way of getting the shot done. So these are several things. So earlier I was telling you one of the incidents where I was kicked by the langurs when I was filming them. This is a small showreel that I made from that particular shoot, which was later broadcast on Animal Planet and Discovery as an entire film for 55 minutes. I have a small clip. I hope you guys can watch that. Just a second. I'm just going for screen sharing here. Screen share. Okay, there it is.
Just a young gun with a quick fuse. I was uptight, wanna let loose. I was dreaming of bigger things and wanna leave my old life behind. Not a yes sir, not a follower. Fit the box, fit the mold, have a seat in the foyer. Take a number, I was lightning before the thunder. Well, I was scheming for the masses. Who do you think you are? Dreaming about being a big star. They say you're basic, they say you're easy. You're always riding in the backseat. Now I'm smiling from the stage while you were clapping in the nosebleeds.
So that was one of the videos that I just had it as my showreel. Now I'll get back to some of the things that you could have seen in that video. If you had noticed, there was a lot of feeding going on in the small clip that I showed you. I usually don't, I mean, I never feed the animals, which is for obvious reasons, and that's the ethics that we follow. This is all happening in the particular area, and I was trying to make a story out of there. The reason why I showed you this video is because in this video, I was also showing a small bits and pieces of the all-male band that I filmed, an all-male band, which I just came to know was existing only when I was filming in the location, and one of the primatologists who was also working there told me about this. He explained that, see, this particular troop is an all-male band, and it consists only of all males. And I was like, okay, is there something like that? Because I was just filming them because they were being a rowdy troop to the main troop that I was already filming there in the location. He said, no, these are just the bachelors who are just out and whatever, da-di-da-di-da. I was like, okay, fine. That's a great learning for me. And only after inputs from such a primatologist, I was able to film a new angle to the film by giving it a new dimension, telling that this is a particular troop that was trying to, it was drama that we created in the film. It was trying to disrupt a piece, which actually happened. And it was being chased by the alpha male of the main troop that I was also filming as part of the movie. This was a huge help because of his inputs in the field. And I was able to bring a huge drama dimension inside the film. So such collaborations are like of immense help to even filmmakers. And likewise, some of my footage, he was able to use it for his study, and he was able to recognize, okay, this is what is happening. And he gave me an open hand telling that, please call me whenever you want and I'm happy to help. Likewise, I was also like really happy to give him all the footage as for his study and everything. This is another thing that we filmmakers are quite happy to do. Although we do a lot of commercial work, we try to help a lot of conservationists around and social activists, as well as a lot of researchers, by giving them footage for their study work and for educational purposes. This is completely out of, this is completely free, as long as it is not posted on YouTube or Facebook, for which is considered as broadcast. So maybe even if you guys have any interests in learning or knowing about more things or more footage, let's talk about it later, or even you can do me a direct message or private contact. We can talk about how we can share the footage for you, and or maybe even film something for you, which you can use for your purpose, which is probably educational or research or collecting data, whatever. So that's one thing. Now, I'll just talk a little bit about some of my experiences in the field. I hope you guys are not getting bored with this. One of the incidents, I mean, it's just a few incidents that I'm talking. So if you have any suggestions or something you find interesting, or maybe if you find that this is not right, maybe this was what was happening, please let me know. I'd be happy to know, because that's why we're here together. The first thing what I wanted to talk was, I was filming some lion-tailed macaques in the water bodies in the Anamalai for some time. So this was something new to me, because I was always filming them either on the canopies or occasionally when they wanted to cross roads, they would get on the floor and cross. And these arboreal animals, I was like never even imagining that they would come down to water bodies. Obviously to drink, yes, but to play and to swim around, it was something new. I don't have the footage to share right now, because that's going for broadcast, and I can't share it right now with everybody. But I can talk about what happened. So there were a few young lion-tailed macaques that were just on the water body, and they were playing around on water. Sometimes it was just by licking on the surface, and they would walk for a certain distance and they were doing this. Sometimes they would just search for something on the floor and they would just fall into the water like any other bonnet macaque would do. This was very interesting, and I just shared, thinking that, oh my God, this is something that's very new to me. And I shared it with the primatologist, and she was like, oh yeah, this is completely normal. This happens always in the field. And I was like, oh, okay. So that's not new, but it did certainly feel new to me, because I was new to the place filming. A lot of these incidents like this, I felt that it was a great thing, and I've showed it to the primates, primatologists, and they've told me that it's just a very normal thing. And there have been also some incidents where I filmed something very normal to me, and it was like, okay, fine, maybe this is very normal. And I showed them, and they felt really happy, telling that this is one of the very few digital records that we have of such a behavior in the field. I filmed some incidents where there has been offensive mechanism for the lion-tailed macaques when I was doing a small film for one of the broadcasters. The entire troop came across a small spectacled cobra, a baby cobra. The baby cobra was just putting up its hood and just waving. I mean, it was just hissing out and offending them. Entire troop, they surrounded the tiny cobra, and they started jumping on trees, and they were trying to chase it off. They were chewing it off. I made an entire sequence out of the whole event, like circling around them and filming the entire thing without disturbing them, to notice what exactly was going on. Obviously, they were on the offensive because they knew it was a tiny animal, and they also knew that it was a dangerous animal. They all did that. But a few weeks later, I also filmed in the same location a small glimpse of a leopard that just walked out. Obviously, I didn't get a footage of the leopard, but I did see that there was a leopard walking. And as soon as the lion-tailed macaques saw them, it was a quick sprint. They just started running about 50, 60 meters, and they climbed into the trees. Obviously, defensive mechanism. They were climbing like any other macaques. This was one of the things. And I've also seen them along with the bonnet macaques. Usually they just fight with each other, but one of the incidents when they were the wild dogs, the dholes, Indian dholes on the floor, a few of them were trying to circle them up. All these macaques got together, which was the bonnet macaques as well as the lion-tailed macaques on the same branch. They were sitting together and they were trying to like chew off the dholes. The dholes were not considering, but that's when we saw the animals closer. And as soon as we saw the dholes saw us, and they were like... scared of our presence, and they moved away. So that was one thing. One of the incidents coming towards man-animal interactions, I would say, not conflicts. Some of the incidents have also been conflicts. To begin with, I was very unfortunate, but also able to film something that happened. I was looking at about a 3.5-4-year-old lion-tailed macaque. It had three of her limbs severed. It was having tie ropes. I very clearly zoomed into the camera and tried to get the footage of the limbs, what happened. Probably someone must have caught the animal and tortured it. I don't know. Maybe because all three limbs were having snares and it was with a lot of ropes, as in with a lot of tights as well. It didn't look like it was tightened from a snare where the animal would have accidentally stepped in. It just looked like a little bit of a torture, and I couldn't see that particular individual after a few months because I am probably thinking that it would have died because three limbs were severed and was still depending on its mother, clinging on. And some of the times it was just a bit too risky for the animal, where the mother would just let it down and walk around. It was really sad to watch that particular incident. And the pretext to this was I filmed a lot of these lion-tailed macaques entering houses in that particular location to look for food. This is also because a lot of tourists have been feeding the macaques on the road. And this has just been happening for the last 10 or 15 years, as what I've heard from the primatologists. And that's been really bad for the animals. They've got the taste of it and they've started looking into the dumps as well, which is open near the houses for the tea plantation workers. When the animals come for these dump food, they also wander into the houses for similar kind. They destroy the entire house as soon as they go inside, breaking open the roofs, and they come out. This is part of all small daily wage workers who get extremely angry when such animals do these things. I'll show you a small clip about the footage that we had. For 1 minute. Just go to that particular one. Please hold on. I'm sharing the screen again. Yeah, there we go. I want the music on this just to show you a small idea about what's going on in the location over there. This is, there are about five troops in this particular location, and some of them have started venturing into human habitation like this. Extremely disheartening to see arboreal animals go like this. So what they do is they go into the dump, they start looking for food, and we know what happens there. Contracting diseases and munching into plastic. Obviously, these animals are very choosy about what they eat, so they don't usually consume plastic, because we could test some of these cat samples, the fecal samples, and we couldn't find any plastic or macro particles. Maybe some micro particles were there, but macro particles weren't present because of these choosy eaters. And we could see a lot of rice and other human food inside. Quite often these animals, when there is not much jackfruit or large enough food, they wander into human habitation, break in, and go into such houses for raids. I mean, sometimes I can only film and from a distance, because you can't really do much. But in certain cases, I have filmed the shot where the animal goes inside and chase the animal out as soon as I know that it's going to destroy the house. Because yes, I have got the shot, but I'm also morally responsible that nothing happens to the property inside. Otherwise, people would get angry and destroy the animal in the future. The other thing that I wanted to talk about was electric poles. So I have filmed these animals stuck like that before. There were three incidents that has happened to me with electric poles and a lion-tailed macaque. The first one I wanted to tell about was this was the first incident. When I was filming this particular animal, I tried to go closer, but The animal seemed to be scared and didn't come down. So I immediately walked back 10 meters and waited for the animal to come down. It was a youngster, probably around 3.5-4 years old. So this particular individual refused to come down and it was just happily playing on the pole top. Suddenly it ventured in, got close and touched two lines where it got electrocuted. Extremely hard to see that. I couldn't really do much. I tried to throw stones at it to probably topple it down, but obviously I couldn't. There were a lot of macaques. I mean, the entire troop was around me and it was just scaring me off not to come closer. So the only option that I had was to document it for evidence and to show it out. Immediately, from amounting some luck for this individual, it dropped down. And it was, I think it was an automatic CPR or something. So it survived. It was lucky that it moved and it started walking around feebly. But then the other troop members just carried it into the forest. I don't think anything else happened because they were quite able to survive from that shock. The second incident for electrocution that I wanted to tell was once a youngster was on top of an electric pole and just was squealing the whole time. The entire troop was on the other side of the road where there were bush and tall trees. But this particular individual couldn't jump across because it was about 15 or 16 meters across. And it was squealing for a long time and I was at a distance noticing this. I immediately ran to see what had happened and I noticed a dog, a feral dog. I mean, a dog that was being tied up in the near or a resident dog or something. It was just at the floor near the electric pole. And it was just waiting for the youngster to come down to grab it. It has happened in the landscape before several times where dogs have caught or even killed lion-tailed macaques when they wander around on the floor. So immediately, the only thing that I could do was chase away the dog and bring the lion-tailed macaque down. I chased the dog away. Luckily, the lion-tailed macaque, the youngster saw that it was an opportunity to get down and run across to its troop. It ran down and it was reunited with its family. So this was one incident where I could save it. There was a third incident when this happened. Once again, I was looking at it from a distance and I wasn't even setting up my camera. I was just looking and observing what the animals were doing across the road. Two of the individuals climbed up the pole and they were playing there. One of it was by the cemented pole, while the other went and touched two ropes, I mean the electric poles, and it got electrocuted. It fell down and it was completely motionless. The other troop this time, the entire troop was surprisingly not doing much or chasing me away. It was just waiting and looking at me. I thought, okay, this was an opportunity to save the animal because I had no other option. I ran close to see. It was completely motionless. With some amount of luck, I just tried to press in its chest for a little bit with some amount of pressure. Obviously, this is not supposed to be done in the field, but I thought it was a humane way to save the animal rather than let it die because it was completely motionless and I couldn't see any heartbeat there also. As soon as I was done with two or three pushes, there was again no motion and I tried it once or twice more. As soon as it was done, there was a small hiccup and then the animal was able to have a heartbeat and started breathing. I was happy and I immediately retracted for the troop members to come in. The troop members came in, they started grooming the animal. They picked the particular individual up and I saw the youngster's eyes open and limbs move across and it was, I think it was fine, so it was able to move across. I'm not sure if it's the right thing to do. I think I need your suggestions and comments on this. What would have you guys done in the field if you had saw something? Have you let it die or was it supposed to be done like this? I'm not sure, but I just felt that this was the right action to do. So that's exactly what I did. Now I'm exiting out of this. Coming back. Okay, so the next thing what I wanted to talk about is sometimes while in the field, we also act with the conservationists or the other groups who are working in the field. Not just filmmaking is what we do, because sometimes we are done with the shots and we're looking out for specific things. And during the downtime, we also try to do other things. Like, for example, in the anomalies, roads crisscross the forests. And when the macaques are trying to cross the road, they get into accident, which you've already seen. So to avoid that, there have been a few staff that have been posted to regulate traffic. And it's just two of them who are trying to do for a huge stretch. of the road. And when in places that they cannot do, I just step in myself with my assistants and we start regulating traffic when we see the macaques on the road. As soon as we inform them, we also try to regulate, asking them to go slower or try to look out for the animals. Or if the animal is passing with the smaller animals, as in like youngsters, we try to hold up the traffic, let the animals cross and then let the traffic move. So some things like that we do. And another major thing that I get angry with people is when the tourists throw food for the animals. Obviously, all of you get angry with that, but that's exactly what we do. We try to shoo them off. We try to tell them that this is not supposed to be done. We try to educate them. And in some cases, I've also gone into fights with them, telling that you're not supposed to be doing this and this is such a danger. Slowly they understand. And then in some cases, they just try to put away us by telling, see, this is who I am and this is who the persons that we know and I'm so influential, blah, blah, blah. Immediately, I give them an answer telling that, see, I may understand or you may understand who you are or the cops or whoever is an official over here may understand who you are, but the macaques don't. So obviously, to give them respect is to give them the space. And when you can feed it today, you cannot feed it every day. And that's not how they're supposed to be. They're supposed to be feeding themselves and not this way. And this has caused a lot of problems. These are the things we try to educate. I mean, this is something that I've learned by observation on the field, as well as learning from the primatologists or nature conservation people in the location. Those are the things. I wanted to talk about one of the things where you saw the lion-tailed macaque entering a house. So there are two incidents how I react to such events. One of the events where I have reacted to the lion-tailed macaques, and one of the incidents where I have reacted to a rhesus macaque in Jaipur's vegetable market. The lion-tailed macaque, it entered a house. I had to chase it out because, like I've told you that incident earlier, where I went in and chased the animal out so that there was nothing destroyed inside the house. And I immediately called for the house owners. They came in and they were like really thankful, telling that thankfully you averted the situation. They're like, fine, it was just bad for the animal as well as you guys. And it would have been a bad situation if it was going inside and destroying your property or even your groceries and food. The other situation was in Jaipur. When I was filming sitting down, I knew that the animals were coming and robbing food from the market. And I was very sure that I couldn't do much or I shouldn't be doing much because one, there was plenty of food there. And the people who were selling knew that the animals were coming and doing it. Obviously, once in a while, they get annoyed. But they knew that these particular rhesus macaques were coming in and taking food. They wouldn't react much. So all they could do was not informing the animal, not showing away, not informing the particular vegetable owner, the market owner, or the seller, or even the chasing away the animal. I just sat there filming the entire sequence where the animal came in, stole the vegetables and just went out and had food. I was filming the whole thing. After it was done, I went and spoke to the vegetable seller, telling that, see, this is what happened. You didn't even realize that this was happening. And I filmed the whole thing. How do you feel about it? He was like, oh, well, this happens every single day, multiple times. We are fine if they take a few things. Obviously, they also need to feed themselves. And this is how these animals have been in the cities for very long. So we are comfortable with that, as long as they don't destroy our entire market or they don't disrupt our entire business. I was like, obviously, that is true. So is it fine that I go ahead with such filming? Are you comfortable with that? They're like, we are absolutely fine with it as long as you don't show us in a bad light. I was like, I'm not showing anyone in a bad light or a good light. I'm just documenting what is happening in the field, which is what we try to do most of times. We don't stand on one side or the other. We just try to show what's actually happening in the field. A lot of people do mistakes, yes, but still some of them have been trying to do ethical things that we've been trying to learn from such people. The other things where I wanted to talk. I think I'll just talk about other incidents from different locations rather than just primates, because I have filmed in different locations ranging from minus 30 degrees Celsius to plus 54 degrees Celsius across the country for different shoots. And that has had various animals ranging from frogs to elephants to different birds. A lot of times, like I said, how we document certain events that has never been filmed before. One of the things is a gharial coming out of a hatchling coming out for the very first time that has never been filmed in the wild before. I'll just show you a small video clip on that. And the other thing is, I have filmed foul brooding of black-bellied terns having their eggs laid in river terns' nests and how the chicks came out. I filmed the entire sequence because I was lucky to be in one particular spot for 60 days. And every day I used to be in that particular landscape for about 12 to 13 hours filming what was going on. And even though I was not filming at some times, I was just constantly observing. This was a huge help for one of my very good friends and a scientist, an avian biologist. So I gave her a lot of inputs on, see, this is what I'm observing. And a lot of things were new to her. And some of things she explained what was actually happening. And it was a good collaboration and learning curve for both of us. So moving on, I'll just quickly show you the Gharial footage, which also has one of the clips where one of the shots where the animal comes about 2.5 meters outside the water to stretch and go back. We still don't know what exactly the behavior is, but it was the very few incidents which has been filmed before. I'll just share the screen for you right now. Quickly, just turn it on. Just a second, sorry. Okay, there is something wrong here. Yeah, I am going to share the screen. Sorry. Sharing the screen. So please have a look.
Birds flying high. You know how I feel. Sun in the sky. You know how I feel. Breeze drifting on by. You know how I feel. It's a new dawn. It's a new day. It's a new life for me. And I'm feeling good. Fish in the sea, you know how I feel. River running free, you know how I feel. Blossom on a tree, you know how I feel. It's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life for me. And I'm feeling good. Dragonfly out in the sun, you know what I mean, don't you know? Butterflies all having fun, you know what I mean. Sleep in peace when day is done, that's what I mean. And this old world is a new world, and a full world.
So that was one of the videos that I wanted to show you. I quickly go ahead with, I hope you had a good notice about that. I mean, you could clearly see the video. In that video, there were some incidents where you could have seen I was really close to the gharials. Contrary to what you may think that it was unnatural how the animal, the babies came out, the hatchlings came out. It was not true, but because we were positioned in the location and we were waiting for this to happen, we were lucky that this happened in the daytime because usually this happens in the night. We were lucky to film when one of the scientists was collecting some samples in the field and they observed something and they asked us to film it immediately. This is when we located and we were waiting for it to naturally come out, go into the water and be with its adults. So that was one of the things that we filmed. And obviously we've had a lot of dangerous situations in the house. This is not the time for talking about it. So I'll move on to the next thing. I was told by Partha that a lot of people, some people from the Northeast, especially from Guwahati are here. I would like to tell that I've also filmed there in the Northeast in Pake for hornbills for a certain episode on different species over there. It will be broadcast about that particular landscape in Animal Planet and Discovery, I think, or probably in a few months from now. It's all under edit stages. And one of the episodes in that particular series that I worked on is also about lion-tailed macaques. So please look out for that. I'll keep you guys posted when it comes online. The last thing what I wanted to talk about, once again, one more small incident that I wanted to talk about when I filmed the lion-tailed macaques. So one incident was when I was filming the lion-tailed macaques feeding on jackfruits. I was closely situated and I was just up close and filming them, taking turns to come feed and go back to their trees. So there were multiple individuals coming and feeding. But then suddenly there was a huge downpour, a huge rainfall that happened. And when that was happening, I was still sitting and filming there for about 10, 15 minutes. When this happened, all the troop members got to their trees and they stuck under the branches to stay away from the tree. But there was one old female that came down to feed on the jackfruit. And it was quite surprising for me that she came out in that amount of rain. She sat, she ate for so long, and then she comfortably went out. I showed the footage once again to the primatologists in the field, and they were like, okay, fine, this is what has happened. What happened was she was using it as an opportunity to have her turn in eating the food, jackfruit specifically, because otherwise she was not being given a chance, because probably she was down in her lineage or something. Maybe she was not in the appropriate category where she could have come and had food, or led before the other individuals could have come. And she used this particular opportunity, despite pouring so heavily, she came down, she had her fill, and then she went up. So that was another incident that I missed out telling up earlier. So I think that's it, guys. I hope it was not too boring, and it's already an hour. So I think we'll start with the question and answers, and maybe you can give me some suggestions on how to improve further.
Hi, Varun.
Hello.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Hey, thanks for the talk. It was really interesting. Very different from what we are used to most of the times these days, because we are mostly into the talks which goes about technical and field stories. Of course, it had a lot of field stories in it as well. So it absolutely kept us on hook for like 1 hour, easily. So we were just there all the time, and people have come up with a lot of questions, and just brace yourself. So I will just read them out to you.
Yeah.
So Ram asks, do you consider checking publications to see if any of this behavior has been described before? Like whatever.
Are you talking about any specific behavior or in general?
I think this is in respect to the fetal cannibalism.
Fetal cannibalism. Okay. As of now, I've just given it to one of the primatologists, and I don't think it has been published yet. So one of the persons that I was talking to, she said she's going to publish this as a study in one of her papers. I was like, okay, comfortable. I was absolutely fine with that. I'm not sure if it has been published already before. Maybe not, maybe yes, but haven't gone into that yet.
All right. Second question, just give me some time. There have been a lot of questions around, so I just have to look for, like, fish for them.
Yeah, and I really hope that it was not too boring for everyone, because I was just talking about a lot of field experiences. Because
no, I think it was pretty interesting for every one of us. I mean, we have been chatting in the back, like, how good this is. Okay, the second question is from Smita. She asks, we are a group of primatologists working on different fields and different primates. So would you like to collaborate with us and have showcased the work which they have been doing for a while, and have your expertise on the field, and bring out the what goes in the field more, for so that it reaches more people?
Absolutely, I'm completely in for that, and I'd love to collaborate with you guys, because obviously without collaboration, science doesn't evolve. And not just that, I'm also happy to help train you guys on how to make better shots or better footage or better sequences or small stories, because you can also be able to communicate your science, which is a key thing in, I mean, it has been a very important thing forever, but then it's more than, it's really important right now with current age. I think I'll be able to help with that as well, if you guys are in for
it. Maybe we can have a workshop later on, down the line.
Absolutely.
So Sukesh from IIC asks, sorry, Did you had any chance to observe or record about Nilgiri langurs as well? Have you spent time with them?
I have filmed them a bit, but not as much as I've done with the other primates. The reason is, one of the reasons is because they've been really shy. But I've also been able to observe them along with the lion-tailed macaques. One, for example, it was a rare case. One of the Nilgiri langurs was living along with one of the lion-tailed macaque troops for a few months. And I was also able to see her groom the babies of the lion-tailed macaques. And the entire troop was completely comfortable with this particular individual being with her. A very rare case, but then not too much about the Nilgiri langurs that I've filmed, because every time in the places that I've seen, they've always maintained a distance at least about 80 to 100 meters from us.
So Dipanita is asking, have you observed cannibalism in other macaques or anywhere else? I think this is also open to researchers also, in case they have also noticed cannibalism or fetal cannibalism of any type in macaques or maybe any primates. I mean, if anyone wants to ask that, answer that, feel free. But Varun, you can start with that.
I haven't personally seen that, but I'd love to hear if anybody else has seen it too. It'd be really new to learn.
All right. So Ram asks, how approachable has been the other primatologist and forest department to you? Would you suggest anything in to either of these people when it comes to interacting with filmmakers?
It is a tricky question, because not everybody is the same. In some places, there has been tremendous support, both from primatologists as well as field staff or the forest department or whatever. But in some places, there have been incidents where the forest department hasn't been really comfortable in helping us. For various reasons that could be, I'm not able to pinpoint what this is the particular reason, but for various reasons, maybe they were insecure, maybe they were not comfortable with letting us to a certain extent or something. So yeah, it completely varies across the country, because in certain places, they are going out of the way to even help field biologists as well as filmmakers to do the study, so that the park and the species and the landscape entirely gets a good advantage over that.
Okay, so one of my colleagues is telling me that there has been one record from Wildlife Institute of India where a female rhesus was seen carrying a dead infant, and later she consumed it after a few days.
Okay.
So, yeah.
I've seen them carrying dead babies, obviously, because everybody would have seen that. But then I've never seen them eat, like, especially this one, especially, which was a miscarriage.
Yeah, it was very interesting. Yeah. So Subhas asked, what would be the conservation measures for that species? I think he mentions lion-tailed macaque.
Okay, lion-tailed macaque conservation measures are underway. For example, one of the things that it was there was regulating the traffic, which happens because roadkills are quite often. The other things that have already been taken place by the Nature Conservation Foundation in the field are like changing the rooftops of houses which are like breakable. And I mean, the staff that are on the road are from themselves, and they also built the bridges for the lion-tailed macaques to cross and walk down. So that is one of the things. And the other thing what they've been doing is spreading awareness to people, telling that, see, this is the thing. Please don't attack the animals and so on. So those are the kind of things that's going on in the field.
Okay. Next question is, sorry. No, go ahead.
I think I missed out a few things, but then talking to different stakeholders, telling that you're supposed to be doing this, these are the suggestions that we have, etc.
Right. Have you faced any intrusion from tourists or onlookers while filming primates, and how do you deal with them?
Tourists, yes, I have had a lot of issues with some people, especially when they're trying to feed them. I've come to that situation, and I've tried to keep them away. I try to instruct them. I try to tell them, see, this is what is happening, and this is why you need to avoid. A lot of people abide by it. A lot of people support, and they understand and go. But some people are a bit aggressive. They try to tell that, see, I'm so and so people. But then you have to explain it to them also, telling that, see, the animals don't understand that. You have to give their space, and you need to protect these animals. And sometimes it is positive. Sometimes it's a bit grungy. Yeah.
Okay. Arijit asks, do you have any personal view on the dead inspection by the lion-tailed macaques, as in where the inspectors who were coming for to check the dead individual.
Yeah.
Were they from all the sexes? Did you see males and females both? And did you know the sex of the individual which was dead?
It was an old female that died. Not very old. She was an old female though, in one of the old females in that group. And to check her out, there were several individuals that came in, which were mixed of both sexes, young males, alpha males. The alpha males didn't groom her. They came close from the other troops especially. They came close, they looked around and they just walked. Whereas the females, a lot of females came in groomed and left. And there were also the youngsters, the juveniles and sub-adults, which tried to pull her up and tried to groom her. So that also happened. And in some places, females that were carrying really young babies, like around 3 to 6 months old babies, they also came and groomed. So it was a mix of different things. Except for the alphas from the other troops, I think there was quite a mix of everyone coming and grooming that particular individual.
That was interesting. Do you have any particular schedule which you follow while filming the macaques?
Particular what, sorry?
Schedule? A schedule or something?
Oh, okay. Yeah, right. Depends on different locations. Pata, 1 minute. I think I'm running out of my battery. I think I'll go and connect it to another room. I hope that's fine for a minute.
Yeah.
Just a second. Sorry.
While we wait for Varun, if you have any questions, do chat in. Use the chat box and please type in your questions. We'll take as many as possible. We are, of course, running out of time, but we'll try to take all the questions which are here.
Hey, I'm back. Sorry.
Yeah, it's okay.
Sorry, I just almost lost my battery there. So, sorry. What was the next thing that you were telling me?
Yeah, what is the, is there a particular schedule you follow?
Yes, the strategy depends on different locations. Because for some locations, I just wander around with the animal for a few days to see how they particularly behave, or if there is a particular way of them behaving, or is there a pattern or something. I sketch out the entire thing, telling that, okay, this is the pattern which I can look forward to, and then create a story out of that and go for it. So that is one of the strategies that worked in places where it's thickly concentrated and where the primates don't move for long distance. But for the lion-tailed macaques, it has been difficult that way to charter them out because they are extremely unpredictable, especially when they make their decisions to move across. And especially when it's a large troop, there are multiple adults which decide which way they're planning to go. So let's say half the troop goes in one direction, the other half is being taken in the other direction by the other adult. And suddenly they realize that they've made a mistake and they shout out for each other, and then it becomes chaos, and then it takes a lot of time for them to regroup. And then they sleep over in, they roost in wherever the locations they're already existing.
Okay, thank you. Zach asks whether do you have some advice for an upcoming wildlife filmmaker, like who wants to take this up, or
absolutely. I'm not in the best position to talk about great things about this, but obviously I can tell you how I started. There are multiple ways in starting wildlife filmmaking. One, you could go do a course like how I've done and then come back and just start out on your own. The other is joining as an assistant or an intern in some of the major production houses, or maybe to a big filmmaker, so that you can learn the nuances of the field and then start by yourself. And the other one that I would not really suggest is to completely start by yourself. The reason why I don't suggest is that the field experience and what you need to do in the field will be there, but it'll be extremely slow. Like any other field, these are the two major ways that I would suggest: studying from a school or maybe joining as an intern to someone. So as soon as you start, obviously the in-depth thing is to completely start making as much as footage as possible, start making them as sequences, and start thinking it as stories, because this is very different from what photography is. Photography is capturing the moment, yes. But when you go into filmmaking, you need to think about the story much before, and you need to think about the shots that need to go in and stitch it together. It's a whole lot of work, and a lot of effort goes into it in the field while trying to make that. So you have to be prepared for that. And economics-wise, yes, you have to spend a lot while buying your cameras or spending in different parks or getting permits and things. But if you're willing to spend a lot of time and effort as well as money for that, then yes, you should try it. But I'm not saying you should only have money to get into the field, because I've known a lot of people who have started this field even without cameras. They've always rented it out or gone into productions, international productions, without their own equipment, but been hired it out. So it's not definite that you always need to get the top-notch equipment to start out. You can always just go to the field, start observing, and try uplifting your skills as a camera person or a filmmaker or a storyteller or an editor, however it is, because it's not just one field. Although it sounds a bit glamorous of being a camera person, there are a whole lot of other things in this field as well, because there's constantly research coming in from the researchers, and then the pre-production stage where you do a lot of thinking and storyboarding and thinking about how to make the movie. And then in production stage where you go out and get the images and or the footage and then come back. And then in the edit room, it all happens into one good piece with good music and sound design. Then it goes out. It's a huge department. It's just not one particular category alone.
Okay. There's another question which asks, in your experience, what do you think, when do you think an animal can attack a human?
Usually when it is disturbed very badly, or sometimes when it's confused or when it's shocked. That's been my experiences so far. Or maybe when it's stalking you, because I have had all these experiences in different locations with different animals. Monkeys have also attacked, crocodiles almost catching me by stalking, elephants chased because of someone else shouting out in the field because of their mistakes. The elephants had to chase us, and it was a narrow escape that I survived. The animals do attack, but yeah, it's only when they are usually disturbed, because there have been so many incidences where the animals have seen me and they are comfortable and they walk off. For example, I was filming tigers in one of the locations, and it was just about 40 meters away from me, and there was no protection for me. I was not in a vehicle, I was on foot. I was sitting down and I was filming. The animal saw me, it was just looking at, snared at me, and was like, okay, fine, and walking, and it walked away. Usually they don't attack as long as you don't disturb them.
Wonderful. Ram asks, given how curious they are, is filming primates is more challenging than filming other species groups? And do you worry whether there will be an observer's bias into this?
Filming primates is extremely challenging, not because they're curious, but because you need to walk a lot with your huge equipment, because they keep moving their positions. And you know, sometimes you're carrying anything between 25 and 30 kilograms of equipment. And repositioning every time and positioning it for your shot is difficult. So that takes away a lot of your time, because you need to quickly reposition and then look at the angle by the time the action is over and they move off. They move off as in they just move about half a meter or 2 meters away. But then still you need to reposition yourself to get that right angle. That way it is challenging. Curiosity wise, yes, we've had a lot of times when the primates come to us and look into the camera, look into the cell phones, or look into the display. They try to do that because they're curious and they want to see what's the reflection about, and what is that particular thing moving, what are the lights. They try to pull things, and such things happen, but not a lot of times it's a problem, because we try to take away the camera. We don't touch the animals. We try to shoo them off, or we try to be comfortable, or we try to be ignorant about it, and they slowly lose their interest and they just walk off. That's the best way to do it, because they start behaving by themselves. Otherwise, if you start getting aggressive to these animals, then like you guys already know, they're not going to react normally. They're going to react differently, and that's not going to look good on video. So we do that. And the bias that you were telling, I'm not very sure about this bias. Maybe we all are, but to an audience, it's just more relatable, I would say, because we are all primates, and looking at primates, which is most of the time it's playful, it's cute. And the other thing about primates is also we get a lot of behavior out of them. They are so reactive, they are so responsive, and you can get to spend a lot of time with them also. So these are some of the things maybe that creates that bias if you're thinking about it.
So there is another question. I would like to rephrase that, in a, if that is okay. That do you make a story after you get a footage, or you have a story ready with you before the footage? And if you don't have a, if you have a story, what do you do when you don't get the footage? I mean, of course.
Both works for us, because sometimes I've gone with a proper story and proper planning, telling that this is what exactly I'm going to film. But in the field, it's completely different what happens. And this is where the edit room comes into play, because while filming such things, we have multiple different things going on in our mind telling that, okay, what about if this doesn't work, we should have an alternate story. So we try to film that also simultaneously. It's a very difficult task, but we try to do that as well, so that if one fails, we have another way to go about in the storyline. And the other thing what I want to tell you is sometimes we just go for footage because we have no idea, because let's say that animal has never been filmed to such an extent before. We just go for as much as possible that we get. It wouldn't be too much of a difference from what they do, because in the field, whatever animal it is, it's just going to do a certain set of things. Like let's say it's going to forage, it's going to sleep, it's going to reproducing. So these are the things that then certain animals are going to do, and the broad categories are going to be similar to most of the animals. So according to that, we try to make it different. And sometimes we create drama only if we are confident that this is going to happen. And in some cases, there have been incidents where we get a very good particular sequence that is happening. Let's say it was a huge hunt sequence, or let's say it was an amazing turning point in a movie itself. We build a story around it. So by building like this, we get that particular clip as the epitome. So we work in multiple ways, and sometimes we also use archival material, which has been filmed much earlier, to fill in the gaps to go according to the story. So there's no one particular way. It's always a stylistic thing that different producers from different production companies do.
Wonderful. There's a question, which again, I want to rephrase it. How do you go about a species which is more elusive?
Well, obviously we depend on a lot of study, because without the study and the intel in the field, we can't really locate these animals, or we can't predict what the animals are going to do. To some extent, we need to be predictable about animals. I mean, we need to predict animals, because we need to get some particular shots that we need to get. And for that, based on study or based on someone's inputs or someone's observations, we prepare an outline of how the plan could go, how our strategy could work, and what if it fails, what we do. I mean, we're not 100% in that, because a lot of times that has failed also, because in some places I've just waited in places for about 13-14 hours, and not once I've even switched on the camera, because the entire day was just waiting and waiting. So you do make, that compromises, which is why you're prepared for staying in the field for several weeks. And obviously the animals can't go without appearing for you or behaving in front of you for several months or years, because they have to do something. Yeah.
Very interesting. There is a compliment coming from Makeba for you. It's a great song selection for the videos.
Oh, thanks. We usually use such cinematic songs for pitch rolls and show reels to show it to some of the producers, telling that, hey, see, this is what we got, and this is how we want to go about, how shall we make a movie? And they get interested by looking at it. It's just a way of marketing, I would say. That's it.
That works. There is a question. It's an interesting question, I would say, from Mohan. He asks, okay, people have this notion that, okay, wildlife filmmaking is a cup of tea for only rich and privileged kids. Is that true?
Definitely not true. So many people have come from a very low level, including me, because I was not a rich or privileged kid. And a lot of my colleagues also, they're not rich or privileged. It was just a lot of perseverance and hard work that they were willing to put. And obviously some amount of luck happens when it's consistent, which we all know. Like I said earlier in while I was speaking, one of my very good friends and a colleague, he still doesn't own a camera, and as in a broadcast camera, but he has filmed for various people in the broadcast department for various international broadcasts. So that's a very simple example.
Indeed. So Subhendu asks, okay, do you have a better choice of lens, especially when you're shooting human primate interaction in urban settings?
Completely depends in the field, because in the field it's always about what you go about instantly. I always carry a wild angle lens and a telephoto lens because we want to get as much as things as possible. Usually my primary lens is a telephoto lens. Reason is because when we're filming animals, we have to stay away from a distance and then film them. So for that purpose, I do a lot of close-ups and the mid shots and everything with such lenses. But for certain things, like how you asked, human primate interaction specifically, I filmed it with telephoto lenses as well, but the most preferred lens for me is a medium zoom lens, which could be around a 24 to 105 or something like that, because that range is where you get a good setup of the landscape. telling that, okay, this is where it is happening, and these are the elements around, let's say, houses, trees, whatever, the elements around. And then you can also zoom into a certain extent, telling that, okay, this is what is happening. So I prefer on multiple lenses in the field, and depending on the scenario, when I'm comfortable telling that, okay, these are the shots that I needed, and this is what I've already got. Now, when I have my safety shots, I go on to the next lens, telling that, okay, now let's go on to the creative side by going to the extreme close shots or other creative things.
Okay. So we are running out of time. We have time for just one last question from Suhas. He asks, how does this film of primates contribute to the society?
So contributing to society, any film for that matter, sometimes it's not direct, because especially these are meant to be both entertaining as well as educating. So our concept is always this: when we try to educate people, we also have to keep it entertained. Because if they're not getting entertained, they wouldn't have the notion of just getting, okay, telling someone, telling them, okay, this is what is happening, this is the right thing to do, and these are the wrong things to do. Yes, it's just talking about the positive things in that particular sequence, but there have been other films that we have done which also talks about the conflicts, the adverse effects of human presence in situations. This, when it is transformed to societies, or let's say to people who watch it, we try to spread it across. Such awareness brings out their own involvement in how to protect the animals, in being aware about what they must be doing or how to behave in front of them. And the most important thing is falling in love with the animals, which is what we want them to do. Because when they empathize an animal, they try to conserve it.
Wonderful. It was really, really wonderful to listen to your talk, as well as the patience which you showed when you are answering the questions. And I think all of us were really entertained, as well as we have come to know about the tricks of the trade which you are doing, and the passion with which you actually do it, as well as the challenges which you face when you are filming these. And right. I would say, as a audience, that a simple click of 10 seconds make a huge difference in what you want to do for that species. Like, if you just put that 10 seconds the 30 seconds YouTube clip to the whole world, now the whole world is talking about it. They know about what is going on, and maybe it will have a feedback into the things, how conservation measures will be taken, and the people will take pride into what they are doing when they see their own animals in their own localities in the movies. Right. It was a wonderful, wonderful talk, and it was really wonderful to have you. I mean, it was really short notice. I just talked to you a few days back. You were like excited, and I was like, oh, fantastic. And I talked to all of the people who were there in AIP, and they were like very happy to have you. There could have been some glitches.
Letting me into this, man, because this is something really wonderful for me as well, because I can connect to all of you guys. We can collaborate. I can learn from you people. And it's such a privilege for me to even talk in front of such experts over here. Because all of you guys are the ones who are actually in the field and fighting for such things to happen and learning so much. And without you guys, I don't think we'll be even able to go in.
I think it goes both ways. Since you are not talking about fetal...
More from your side, to be honest.
I wouldn't say that. Let's keep it equitable. But thank you so much. But thank you so much for giving us, 1.5 hours. And that's a lot in today's world. So I would really like to thank you for the wonderful talk. Maybe we can organize something else with you later on.
Absolutely. And I'll be in touch with all of you guys and have chats further on also. So, it was a privilege to join the Association of Indian Primates. So thanks a lot to you guys for even sitting for so long and not, I'm fairly sure most of you are bored already, but then...
the message kept coming that we are not bored, keep it going kind of. So yeah, actually I would like to thank the participants also who... we had some issues with YouTube and we couldn't do as good as we thought we would be able to do it, but we are still in the early phases and we are getting there. And thank you. I want to say thank you to all the participants who made sure that they sit for 1.5 hours and be there with us. So AIP is going to organize more talks like that. Some will be more technical than others. Some will be, but what I can assure you, they all will be wonderful. And I hope you can all ask more questions. Actually, you can ask more questions to Varun over the period of time by logging into AIP's Twitter account or Facebook. We are there as Indian Primatologist. Do register yourself if you're not there yet. We have WhatsApp group also. You can find it from one of the people who are there in the group. And thank you so much for having so many questions for Varun. And it was really engaging. And thank you, AIP, other members who really helped me out. And I would say this was a fantastic experience. We look forward to have you again very soon.
Thank you very much, guys. And appreciate for all your comments that's been coming in. And appreciate you all for the outstanding work that you guys do in the field. Big up to you guys for more positivity in this hard times. I hope we all get out to the field and do our excellent work like we are always used to, and not staying indoors for too long. And good health to you guys. And thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Cheers, guys.
Bye-bye.